My name is Robert Pascoe. I'm from Victoria University in Melbourne. So I was there last time, the last bit of conference, and I'll be there again, I hope, in Genova. So it's great to see so many familiar faces from Melbourne and to be part of this conversation, which is so wonderful and so enriching of all of us. I want to first of all do something we do in Australia very commonly, and that is to acknowledge country, to acknowledge that we are meeting on the island whose traditional owners, the Lenape people, were here long before the Dutch and long before the rest of us arrived here on Manhattan. So it's great to welcome any members of that clan who happen to be here today, and to thank you for the use of your land. I also want to say just very briefly how, having organised conferences myself for many times, many years, many places, I just want to deeply acknowledge the work that Anthony and his team have done. It's just extraordinary. I mean, just the thought of bringing us all here safely and to have this conference is remarkable in itself. And I think we should remember the amount of work that's involved this kind of conference. And every time we bump into these people helping us set up just now, or the people we meet during the conference, to thank them as best we can by our cheerful attendance and our contributions. So it's great to, and really they've done an amazing job, as far as I can tell, of bringing us all together. Today we've got Agata DeSantis, who will start us off with a short clip from some of her work before we hear from the other speakers. Would you please welcome Agata DeSantis?
Good morning. So today I'm going to show a clip of a film I just finished not long ago that we premiered it at Montreal's Italian Week in August, and then it aired on CBC television in Canada in August, which is kind of like the PBS of Canada. So the film is called Terra Mia, and for the past few years I've, as the next generation of my family has come into the world, I've been really preoccupied with the future of my community, and that is the Italians of Montreal. The biggest wave of Italian immigration to Canada happened in the 50s and 60s, which means now we're at the second and third generation of Italian Canadians coming into their own. And in a multicultural city like Montreal, many of these children, second, third generation, don't necessarily have Italian heritage on both sides. So, you know, not only are they second, third generation removed from the motherland, chances are there's two motherlands involved. And in Canada, we're not a fan of the term assimilation, especially in a multicultural city like Montreal. We really talk about integration and adaptation, and it's really a journey that all immigrants and children of immigrants experience when they arrive. So I've had this question on my mind for a while, and so the questions of what is the community going to look like in the coming years, in the coming decades, will we even be able to call ourselves a quote-unquote Italian community after all these generations? And so this is sort of the underlying premise, the underlying theme of the film that I directed and produced. The film is called Terra Mia, and it's what we call a POV film, so a point of view film. So I act as both the narrator and the director. And I set up the film as in little vignettes, so I'm sort of meeting up with different people in the community to talk about this and topics that are related to the future of the community. I'm going to show you today one of the vignettes, and of course, because it was a very personal film, my family is part of the film. So we're going to show a clip featuring my mom and my brother with just a little introduction, and then I'll have a few more comments to make after that. When we were kids, every birthday was celebrated the exact same way. On a Sunday with family, lots of homemade food, and mom's traditional Italian sponge cake, made from scratch. Most of our favorite memories from our childhood center around food, or rather, what the food made happen, the gathering of friends and family around the table. As my siblings and I got older, well, our palates grew more sophisticated. And so we wanted modern cakes, bought at the bakery, with fancy toppings and bold flavors. We wanted what our non-Italian friends were getting. We wanted our birthdays to be more Canadian. And more importantly, less Italian. Now, older and wiser, and with an even more sophisticated palate, my siblings and I always have one special request from Mom. No need for lavish gifts or for fancy outings. We want her traditional sponge cake, with one layer of vanilla and one layer of chocolate custard, and topped with icing, sprinkles, and maraschino cherries. Mom's cake isn't just delicious, it's an ode to our upbringing, to our family traditions, to some of the best memories we had as kids. Today, my brother Peter has asked Mom to teach him how to make one of her specialties, eggplant parmesan. If we're going to keep the family coming together around the table, we need to know how to do it.
This is one of the classic recipes in Italian cuisine, and everybody knows eggplant parmesan. Flour on the eggplant, then with egg that has pepper and salt.
No, just così, perché un po' è grande pure, così. Scola un po' che assai la prima volta.
Okay. We grew up eating this, so it's one of those where, as the generations go through, and you know, we start handing them down, this is one of the classic dishes that I want to make sure that I know how to make the same way that mommy makes it. I need to retake this because I need a nice brown color as a reference here. E questa è salsa normale, come fai il brodo?
Sì, sì, come fai la salsa con la
pasta. That I know how to do already. I'm just gonna keep taking pictures of the recipe because pictures are worth a thousand words.
How often do you make tomato sauce from scratch, Peter?
Never, because mommy always gives us a ton of tomato sauce.
It's part of your doggy bag.
But it's in the notes, it's in another page. Because in Italian cooking, it's all about feel and not really about quantities, exactly. E devi mettere un po' una sola latte.
Sì, perché dopo. E poi metto dall'altro lato, sempre che ha girato.
Così.
Un po' così, esatto. Che si devono chiudere I buchi.
This is one of those parts where I'll just do it my way after.
But not mom is watching.
George, are you ready to start eating eggplant parmesan on a weekly basis? That's why eggplant parmesan is one of the best dishes. Makes for the best leftovers. You can eat it cold out of the fridge.
Do you think you're gonna teach this little guy Italian recipes?
He already likes to learn, and he already likes to cook. He watches me at the stove all the time.
Peter, have you and Georgia talked about what languages you're gonna teach Nicholas? Because he's half Italian, half Greek. Obviously, he's gonna learn English and French at school.
We speak English at home because, and to him, often. However, we do throw in a bit of Italian or Greek, depending on who's talking to him, but a few little words here and there. He really is gonna pick up by spending time with grandma. We'd like him to learn both languages, so basically, in the end of the day, he'll speak four languages, Italian, Greek, English, and French. Like you said, French you learn at school. The hard thing is Greek and Italian, so even for me, I speak Italian to mommy and all our elders in the family, aunts and uncles. My Italian is still dialect. It's a bit broken because I don't speak to them every day. My worry is that he's gonna understand for sure. It's just, we have to keep him practicing.
So, se pensiamo alla lingua, è strano perché io e Peter siamo solo 8 anni di differenza, però io ero la più grande, però l'italiano mio è meglio di quello di Peter. Perché i figli più piccoli, quando incominciano i figli grandi alla scuola, dopo allora viene difficile a parlare con i genitori. Giocano più con gli adulti, più quello più grande, e sono più staccati dai genitori, è dura apprendere la lingua.
So, almeno quando siamo cresciuti, mi ricordo, io sapevo penso, più della musica di anni 60 e non la musica qua.
Sì, perché come ho detto prima, tu eri la prima figlia, allora no, non ci avevo scelte in casa, quelle ci stavano.
La musica italiana, I tengo a casa,
I dischi
italiani.
Tutti i dischi di papà.
5-3, 5-3, 4-5, 3, na-na-na-na-na-na-na. And I heard, quando sono ascoltato quello la prima volta, quando ho piato I dischi di papà, era come, it brought me back to my childhood. That I will show them.
C'era un disco che I bambini mi scappa la pipì papà e tutti la ce l'avevano che cantavano là mi scappa la pipì papà.
Perché quando io ero piccolo noi non andavamo a comprare la musica inglese.
No, perché quelle che
c'era a casa teniamo sui dischi italiani.
No, ma quando tu eri più grande.
Yes, that's when it changes.
Dopo musica Michael Jackson, Madonna è entrata a casa e la musica italiana è piata un po' nella backseat.
And so, dopo ascoltiamo più la musica sopportata lì.
Se pudesse pedir porque era o più giovane, assunto di meno da música italiana.
Se assunto di meno, da quella dopo si è attaccata a quella, automaticamente succede così.
You hungry? I hope you guys are all hungry. Putting it in the oven. 425 for 45 minutes.
5-3, 5-3, 4-5. So I love that scene because it really talks about sort of the struggles we're having in terms of keeping the culture going, especially with language that came up a lot in the film. That the young people seem to want to be able, want to keep the language going, but acknowledge that it's going to be difficult. So it was interesting. I sort of, you know, I came into this film with certain ideas, and some of the conclusions surprised me, but in, I guess in a good way. One of the things that really shouldn't have caught me off guard, but did, and the theme even came up during our first conference in Melbourne, is that the transmission of culture is really happening between the grandparents and the kids. It's really not the parents. And even I interviewed, for example, a group of 20-something-year-olds who are studying at McGill University, who, after all these years, have just started an Italian student society 2 years ago. It never existed before. And they admitted to me that their attachment to the Italian culture is coming from their grandparents, not their parents. And that seems to be a continuing theme. So even in my family's case, we sort of, we made a pact when the first, when my mom's first grandchild was coming, that she would only speak to the kids in Italian. And it's working. She only speaks to them in Italian, and they understand, and they pick up some words. But the parents, so my brother, for example, does not speak Italian to his son. So obviously, in terms of that direct connection to the Italian community, it is coming from the nonni, which is kind of cool. The question, of course, happened, what's going to happen the next generation, when those grandparents are not, you know, the nonni that came from Italy. So that's to see in another generation. Another conclusion that came from this film is that we have to, so as a collective, speaking of course my experience with the Montreal community, is we have what we call the old, I call the Old Boys Club, who started the main organizations in the community and are still the leaders of those organizations. And what's happened, I see that with even my family's association, is the Old Boys Club are having trouble letting go of the reins. And so what they're doing is they're sort of dictating what the younger generation should be doing, how they should be continuing their culture, and that's not working. So when I talk to the people in their 20s and 30s, the second and third generation, what they're telling us is, if the older generation wants to listen, is you gotta let us dictate how we're going to keep the community going. So for example, this group at McGill University, they started the organization themselves, which means they're dictating how they're going to celebrate their culture and continue their culture on campus. So that's something I'm noticing is going to be very difficult for the community in Montreal, and I'm assuming other communities as well, is that they have to let the new generation dictate how the community is going to evolve and change, because it will. What's happening, of course, the language is a big issue. The older generation wants us to keep, you know, speaking Italian at events. It's impossible because we've got, you know, generations of kids who speak very little Italian but are very proud of being Italian, and that's what's important. And that was sort of the biggest conclusion that I found making the film, is that we're actually going to be okay. And the reason we're going to, I feel we're going to be okay, is the second and third generation are still proudly calling themselves Italian. So if that continues, that means there is going to be some sort of Italian community. It's just going to adapt with the generations. And I just want to add a note, because in Montreal, what happens, and I had some of the people in the film tell me stories, in Montreal, the assumption is that most of us are from somewhere else. So when someone in Montreal asks you, what are you, we'll say Italian. And not necessarily, oh, I was born in Montreal to Italian parents. And so what some of these kids are realizing is when they go, let's say, onto a university setting or into an international city, their instinct is to say, I'm Italian. And so people are like, oh, you're from Italy. And then they'll have to explain, oh, well, actually, my parents or grandparents are from Italy. So we have that sort of interesting distinction in Montreal, is when we say I'm Italian, I'm Portuguese, I'm Greek, in Montreal it's understood amongst other Montrealers, of that origin. So that's kind of cool. So those were sort of the three conclusions with the film. So I'm going to save sort of more discussion for the Q&A if you guys have any questions about the film and other things that came up. So thank you.
Eliana Maestri is going to be talking about a very interesting artist, John Catapan, who's working both in Melbourne and in New York, looking at Catapan's work as a way of trying to understand transnational identity.
Lively, vibrant, cultural, artistic, creative, imaginative, inventive, multicultural and multi-ethnic, and better than Sydney. This is how Melbourne is often depicted within Australia and outside Australia. Now, attracted by this imaginary, I applied for a 2014 research fellowship at Monash University, Melbourne, in order to look at how Melbourne-based artists visualize Italian experiences of migration. A number of research projects have been devoted to the investigation of Italy in Italy and out of Italy, namely a country constructed and reconstructed in discursive narratives of migration. But a zone which remains unexplored is the visual, in my opinion, and in particular how visual artists of Italian descent reflect on the malleability of Italian culture and the key elements of a transcultural and translingual nation in motion: mobility, space, and language. And I'm going to focus on these three elements. Home to the Victorian College of the Arts and the Royal Melbourne Institute of Technology, also known as RMIT, the city of Melbourne has trained a generation of artists, including those of Italian descent, especially since the implementation of Australian multiculturalism initiated by the 1973 government. At that time, Australians were encouraged to explore the art scene as an ideal stage for the multiplicity of voices in multicultural Australia, multi-ethnic Australia, and situate their artistic sensitivity within a web of global connections. As John Catapan, and we'll see, here he is, second generation Italian in Australia, eminent Melbourne-based visual artist and current director of the Victorian College of the Arts in Melbourne. So as he says, the sense of coming out of a European orbit became important, end of quote, in the 70s, and motivated him to leave Australia temporarily, surf the globe, and connect with his cultural origins and artistic roots. So here are my research questions today. How do Australian artists of Italian descent display their journeys across continents and imaginary lands? How do they visualize languages and spaces in motion? And finally, how does their artwork translate a sense of belonging while straddling multiple worlds? For the artists that I have interviewed to date, belonging means a longing for multiple places in between desire lands to belong. John Catapan, for example, admits humorously, "My father used to say, if you're a migrant," and I'm quoting him, "you're always gonna sit with your bum on two chairs, you know. You're always between two places. In the middle is a fantastic place to operate," end of quote. Now, due to time constraints, I will discuss one major artist, John Catapan, born to Italian parents in the 50s and raised at the dawn of multiculturalism in Australia, between generations, ethnicities, and artistic practices. His spatial locations in between places and cultural affiliations makes his work highly autobiographical, mobile, hybridized, and almost by default translational. Translation represents the artist's modus operandi, providing him with processes of signification. Here I will avail myself of language-based theories of space and thick translation, which, although do not seem to share common ground, prove to be useful in understanding how space and language can be conceptualized, visualized, and translated into layered and thick zones. Now, if we look at Catapan's artistic output today, we can identify almost by immediately a shared ground, the city. Now, translation studies scholar Sherry Simon confirms migrants' attraction to the city as, and I quote, as a space of productive diversity, end of quote, and desire. In Catapan's work, urban landscapes and cityscapes are superimposed and layered territories so that, as he says, people can claim their own, end of quote. I do not have time to show you the development of Catapan's cityscapes phase from the very beginning, but I will focus on one of the major turning points in his career, his experience in New York and immediately after New York. And this is both to pay tribute to this city now and to show the crucial role played by New York in the formation of the artist's aesthetic philosophy on, and the three elements, mobility, space, and language. After visiting a number of European cities, Catapan aimed for New York and obtained a 1991 arts residency. As art historian Chris McAuliffe claims, Soho was awash with galleries and boutiques. Many visiting artists emerged from this Aladdin's cave with materials neither seen nor considered before, end of quote. Now, McAuliffe's book-length study of Catapan's art is impressive, but the aspect which, in my view, is not given enough attention is the artist's appreciation of the anatomy and morphology of the city, of New York, as a migrant city and as a city text. We'll explore these concepts very soon. Now, in New York, Catapan presenting his On the New York installation, and starting the city submerged that we can see here, a cycle of works, which, and I'll show you another one, he further evolved back in Australia. Now, the piece of work that we can see here, we'll go back to the first one, belongs to the Under New York installation and also to the Travel Suit, a more recent collection illustrating, as he says in an email that he sent me, the beautiful ability of drawing to act like, the beautiful ability of drawing to act like a visual travel diary, end of quote. This painting, like others in the same collection, strikes us as being full of dots in different numbers, shapes, and forms. Catapan claims that the dots, and this is a key piece of information, the dots are data and codes encapsulating data. In other words, they are signs and symbols translating information, numbers, files, facts, figures, digits, and statistics produced and processed by information systems and digital technologies in the city. Works produced in New York and immediately after New York, but still part of the same cycle of works, for instance, and I can show you this one very quickly, they aim to visualize the flow of people, capital, and information characterizing such global cities as New York. In particular, these paintings are dominated, as you can see, by streams of lights whose dots reflect the haziness typical of particles emanated out of office windows by such electronic devices as computers, laptops, screens, mobile phones, and forms of digital communication and data transmission. So how exactly does Catapan reflect on the idea of mobility, space, and language? Just a little bit of theory here. Cultural theorists Henri Lefebvre and Michel de Certeau emphasize the linguistic fabrication of space and the interrelation between social practices and the textualization of space by using language inflected terminology. Languages, verbal and nonverbal signs partake in the social practices shaping human relations actualized in space and fashioning perceptions and consumptions of space. Space appropriated, manipulated, inscribed, and designed by signs become linguistic landscapes invested with spatial inscriptions, language practices, and discourses on space. In other words, space is a multi-layered text governed by ideologies. Now, the confluence of various signs, including the linguistic one, and the interaction between space within spaces are diachronically exemplified in the book build. Here it is. Yep. Now, dots and circles scattered across the canvases and making points of contact between two superimposed cities, New York and Melbourne here, merge forms of communication developed chronologically across centuries, the verbal and the digital ones. Now, in the book builder, the communication system invading these global cities, Melbourne and New York, are represented both by heaps of books, namely the foundation and scaffolding of medieval buildings, and, as Katapan says, by lights, pinpricks of information, end of quote. The painting is accompanied, as you can see, by two vignettes, visualizing the fact that in the past, the buildings were made out of books and therefore of written signs and verbal languages. As Lefebvre maintains, the city was and remains object. Its objectivity or objectality might rather be closer to that of the language which individuals receive before modifying it, or to that of a cultural reality, such as the written book, end of quote. So in the book builder, linguistic codes and symbols, including those used in digital communication and transmission of data, represent visual layers, or better, as Katapan says, narrative layers deeply embedded in the painted space. Now, just like travelers looking at cityscapes and topographical similarities from an airplane window, Katapan says, Katapan's implied viewers admire the complexity of the city text from afar, evoking Michel de Certeau's The Practice of Everyday Life. Now, Certeau, I'm sure you're all familiar with the book. I'll just quote it very quickly. Certeau describes the view of the whole of New York City from the top of the World Trade Center as an intricate fabric of words and letters, and I'm quoting him. The tallest letters in the world compose a gigantic rhetoric of excess in both expenditure and production, end of quote. Now, in line with Certeau and Lefebvre, here New York and Melbourne are city texts, or textual cities spreading across vast linguistic landscapes. Now, a number of art historians and critics have written on Katapan's artwork, but they do not reflect at any length on how the artist's position as a member of a multimodal and polylingual community shapes his aesthetics and world vision. Most of them acknowledge his migrant background, but they do not mention it unless this is visibly obvious, like here. Furthermore, there is no mention of the implied viewers, multilingual, multi-ethnic, multi-skilled viewers, populating global and cosmopolitan urban centers. Katapan's artwork, made in the heart of cosmopolitan cities, New York in primis, with their mobile population of migrants and travelers, invites the multicultural viewer to unpack the layers of the city, the layers that the city has acquired over time, its resemblance to other cities, its acoustic cacophony, the changing face of its signposting buildings, and its textual and spatial co-creation at the hands of multilingual speakers and users of different electronic and digital devices. So, New York, we'll go back to this one, offers the artist the opportunity to visualize the global city as a text-modulated, layered, and migrant mobile phenomenon. The entire painting is indeed layered with acts of migration, displacement, and transfer from Melbourne to New York and back, which are also fundamental attributes of the translational process. Loredana Polezzi reminds us that, and I'm quoting her, the connection between translation and mobility is often traced back to the etymological roots, the Latin word translatio, indicating the movement or transfer of objects and people across space, end of quote. Translation as a mode of signification appears not only as the visualization of polylingual encounters, but also as a method of artistic production. The years that follow New York represent a significant turning point, marking the start of Catapan's datascape phase, refined during his visits to other global cities, Seoul, Rome, Hong Kong, and Tokyo, for example. In these paintings, we'll see this one and next one. Now, in these paintings, New York is not the center, it's not center stage, but one of the strata enriching the physiognomy of the global city. And Catapan corroborates by saying, and I'm quoting, "It's not one city, it's a cut and paste job. There is a little bit of Sydney, a bit of Melbourne, a bit of New York, a bit of London, a bit of Singapore," end of quote. Cityscapes are scanned and superimposed digitally here and then marked or translated manually by the painter. And the painter says, "The beautiful thing about it is that the information is captured digitally, but in translation, it becomes very much about a unique kind of mark making. So, although I may be trying to replicate the look of the pixel or of a digital screen, you become aware of the fact that there's texture. There are particular kinds of marks that are in my painterly handwriting," end of quote. Now, the painter's manual marks replicate the pixel-style dots and therefore all the signs, codes, languages that populate the cityscape at hand. So here Catapan thick translates the text. He adds layers of subjective interpretation, which while providing glosses, annotations, and explanations, enrich the text. They annotate the mechanism that participate in the transformation of the global city, that is to say, the polygonal conjunction of artificial urban inflected sign systems. Now, why is it important to understand Catapan's thick translation practice? The artist reminds us that globalization and the ensuing circulation of objects and people increase anxiety and endless replication mechanisms. These mechanisms, also facilitated by technology, lead to standardization and, as the artist claims, fear of sameness. These fears are projected onto Catapan's implied viewers, identified with travelers and migrants. Whereas global travelers, and I'm quoting Michael Cronin here, can only report on a world that is about to lose its distinctiveness and leave us adrift in a standardized world, end of quote, migrants, especially Italian-Australian migrants or Italian migrants in Australia, fear sameness in situ, namely domestication and assimilation into a culture that misrepresents them. These Italian migrants have resisted language loss, sought translation services into English, and kept their traditions alive. Thus, as Stephen Castles, a sociologist in Sydney, says, paving the way for Australian multiculturalism. Catapan celebrates migrants' unique contribution to urban linguistic landscapes, especially by adding pixel-style dots and marks to his work. These thick marks, translating verbal, visual, and electronic systems, are an attempt to grasp the urban inflecting signs and languages spoken by generation of migrants. And I just want to say something, second-generation migrants especially are renowned for their tentative competencies in the second language and their desire to bring them to life in computer-mediated spaces, for example, WhatsApp, and so on. Now, to conclude, Catapan's thick translated cities celebrate, and I'm quoting here Pennycook's, one of Pennycook's expressions, celebrate the sedimented activities and practices that are still in motion. New York has helped him tease out the differences, sculpting urban layouts and linguistic landscapes, and acknowledge the migrants' writing of the city. Not only are the assonances and dissonances between their verbal languages brought into the picture, literally speaking, but the interface between computer-assisted spaces and linguistic spaces is also displayed and challenged. And where is Italy in all this? I have not had the time to mention this because I spoke about New York mainly, but I would be happy to discuss it later with you. Catapan's paintings are full of blue. It is the Venetian blue. It is the Venetian ultramarine blue, he says, and we can see it here mainly. And I want to conclude with a quote from Marco Polo's The Invisible Cities by Calvino that has inspired the Catapan's production. Every time I describe a city, I must speak first of a city that remains implicit. And for me, it's Venice. Thank you.
There has been a gap, a generational gap, and however, very true, the grandmothers, even in my experience in university, because I've been teaching at Casa Italiana and Nazareth College, so the community outreach, you know? And I've been seeing this scenario with the grandmothers there, and also in university teaching, I've seen that gap and the student identifying themselves as Italian, even if the last name doesn't have any traces anymore, going to their grandmother and the relation with food that you very well, you know, made explicit in your piece. But I'm wondering if you see a change, because in Rochester we see that, where the newer generation are owning this, going to the language. They don't have the language anymore, like you, you know, made clear in this moment with your brother, but they want their children to learn Italian, and they made a very deliberate act by coming to Casa Italiana and engaging in the children education. So I'm just wondering if you see that change happening as well.
Well, in Canada, if we look at Italians in Montreal and we look at Italians in the rest of Canada, there's a distinction. Italians in the rest of Canada, even first generation, have not kept the language going the way we have in Montreal. And there's all kinds of political, I think, reasons for that. But what's happened is il voglio is there. So the want to keep the language going is there. So some parents make a conscious effort to send the kids to, for example, we have Saturday morning Italian school. There's some school commissions that have Italian lessons like during the lunch break, so kids can learn Italian there. So they want to, they don't always accomplish. But what happens is the kids themselves, like say when they become young adults, some of them, for example, will go to Italy to do intensive language lessons. So the kids themselves realize I'm missing something if I don't speak Italian. But it's an individual thing. There's no collective consensus on that.
I think when she means by Quebec, when she means in Montreal, the Italians are different or they're distinct, it's precisely because the legislation in terms of language and establishing French as the language of majority made it so that the Italian community was able, ironically enough, to maintain, notice the importance of maintaining mother tongue. And so in Montreal, you'll find the community speaking much more Italian than in the rest of Canada, or as we say, the Rock. The Rock, the rest of Canada. And Montreal tends to not like, or Quebec tends to not like the rest of Canada, but that's another issue. That's another panel. That's another panel. So that's what happens. And the Montreal Italians and the Italian is actually referred to as trinary because of this negotiation between the three languages, the English majority, the French inside Quebec and in Montreal, and then the Italian and the various dialects makes it so that the not only the Italian is spoken, but it is spoken in addition to in the second and third languages generations. In my case, one of the parents will speak Italian and the other parent will speak the language of the majority. So there is the issue of the mother tongue now is almost is binary. There's not one mother tongue, there's two, and Italian is part of it. So it's good news, but it still remains very fragile. Because in certain part of the city, Italian will be taught. In the western part of the city, or where they're more quote-unquote Anglo-Francos, Italian will not be the primary choice as a third language.
I think this is probably in keeping with what we're stating. I'd like to see if I can get this straight. There was a historian by the name of Marcus Lee Hansen who won a Pulitzer Prize for his work, and let me see if I can get it straight. I want to refer to my comments. He wrote that in his research that what the son wishes to forget, the grandson wishes to remember. I don't know if some of you are familiar with his work. And his hypothesis, it really, I think probably most of you are familiar with his work. And I think that he really writes about this issue of the search for ethnic identity. And I think that's what we're all talking about. And Hansen really, his work was really rather pioneering back in the 30s, and he was a Norwegian, and really did a lot of research with Canadians. So I think that it's really rather apropos that those of you who have done, and all of you did such remarkable work here this morning and presented such beautiful, beautiful work, all of you up there today, so thank you. But I couldn't help but just, your work really resonated for me, and I couldn't even remember Hansen's work, but it just popped up in my head. While you were all up there, his work popped up for me. Yes. I couldn't even remember his name, but I had to go back in my head from 40 years ago.
In my notes, I said so-and-so's law from 1943. Okay. Now, you got it, Hansen. But what's more remarkable about Hansen is not that he was just Norwegian, but he was writing at a time before the second generation had come to maturity, let alone the third generation. He saw the future from the 1940s, which is a remarkable thing. Yeah.
My name is Bea Mori. I'm an artist as well as a writer. And I came because Eliana wrote to me and said, I'm going to be here, can you come? So I took the train down. I live in Vermont now. But I did a big project at Ellis Island, utilizing many of those interviews that you're talking about. And was published as a book, can you hold this for a second? Italian American Odyssey, actually, by Fordham Press, which has a lot of art and writing, but the thing that's interesting in terms of what you're talking about is that many of the interviewees, it follows seven generations. And so it's like the big question is, how do we pass on culture generation to generation? And it varies in each generation, which is very interesting. And by the time we get to the sixth or the seventh generation, it's the food and the grandmother that constantly come up. And being third generation myself, my great-grandparents and my grandparents came through Ellis Island in 1901. And having grandchildren to whom I spoke Italian, the first language they heard from my lips was Italian. They understand a bit. And so I'm hoping they've taken some Italian lessons, but it's very difficult because I don't live with them. Usually when I'm down in Boston, I will speak Italian with their mother, especially, I do it on purpose, so that they will be very curious and they will pick up one word or another, do you know what I mean, be very excited if they get the gist of things. Or if I want to say something to them that I don't want their little brother to understand, I'll say it in Italian and they'll get it and they love it. And that's how I learned the language, although it was spoken by the women in my family at home. Anyway, thank you for your work. It's absolutely fabulous and very important work. Sempre avanti.
Want to thank all the speakers very much for a wonderful session, but several people have mentioned grandmothers a few times, and I just want to say that one of the most remarkable language revival efforts in the last 50 years was brought about by grandmothers in New Zealand, the Kohanga Reo methodology in a more extreme case than any that have been cited, where the Maori language was practically dead. There were no children who spoke it anymore. And unlike Italian in Quebec or anywhere else, which if it were to disappear there, it would still remain in many other places. The language itself is not absolutely endangered, just locally endangered. Maori was endangered globally. And in 1980 at the Beehive in Wellington, the Parliament building, they had a council of reflection on this crisis, and the old women put themselves forward as the recoverers of this language, and they devised this activity to skip a generation, basically. So just like in your film, the middle generation, the parents of the children who didn't speak the language anymore, agreed that they would allow the grandmothers to raise the children for extensive periods of time. But it requires really enormous investment of time. And they produced the first generation of 4 and 5 year olds speaking the language for a very, very long time. And then the New Zealand government responded by allowing primary schools, or elementary schools as you would say here, to teach the language as an introduction into the school. So there is now almost an entire generation of children who've grown up speaking a language that was practically dead and was revived by this initiative from the ground up of community activity with a lot of artistic and creative support from people, because it's not possible for these things just to happen within narrow sectors of the society. But I just wanted to say that because people have made these comments, and there are sometimes, as Rob said at the beginning, a lot of things that immigrant populations can learn from First Nations experiences, which are often more extreme forms of what we have been through.
This conversation about language maintenance and revival, of course, comes back several times during the next 3 days. If you look at your program, you'll see this afternoon, tomorrow, and on Saturday, there are particular moments where these issues will recur. But I think we can take from this session 3 or maybe 4 really important things. The point that you made, Maria-Louisa, about Hansen's law, that we shouldn't expect the children of immigrants to want to know about where their parents came from. The parents' stories can be really boring. Because they get mixed up with issues around how we relate to our parents and how we want to push back from our parents and their incessant stories about the times back before. The second thing, however, that came through was very clearly was that immigrants themselves produce change. And towards the very end, ELIANA made a very important point, quoting Stephen Castles, that it was the Italians who produced multicultural Australia. It wasn't the Irish. The Irish were downtrodden. The Irish were marginal. The Irish were pushed to the margins by the British majority. It was the Italians. In the 50s and 60s, they said, no, we actually don't like being part of your British culture. We want to remain Italian. Thank you very much. And they pushed back. And some of the people who are still alive today, like Nina Randazzo and others, the editor of the newspaper Il Globo, were part of that story. And so were the women. The Italian story in Australia is a very very important example of this pushing public policy in certain directions, very similar to the Canadian story. But the other thing I think is really important has come through very clearly in the Canadian case, which I really enjoyed because my daughter was at McGill in the 2000s and I got to meet people from Concordia, people from McGill, was that the Quiet Revolution that we heard talked about a minute ago was part of the catalyst for the Italian Renaissance in Quebec and in Montreal. Because the Quiet Revolution, in a way, was the same process. It was the French who had been working class, who had been pushed aside by the British majority of Canada, saying, no, that's enough. So the British all left in a wonderful flight of capital from Montreal to Toronto.
Not everyone.
But the ones who stayed behind were the beneficiaries. So my friends at McGill University were astonished that they didn't leave. McGill seriously considered leaving Montreal to run with the rest of the British back to Toronto. They chose to stay for the benefit of that university. That university grew as a consequence. That university, people there actually began to learn French, which was remarkable because they're living in a French society, but they're all speaking English. They began to learn French, and so, and also in drama, in theatre, before filmmaking, that you guys have been talking about, there was this wonderful resurgence of minority languages in Quebec and in Montreal in particular. And I think that's really fantastic. I mean, that's a really nice story. And going back again to this idea that John Canepan tells us about the cities all looking the same, that ain't Montreal. that ultramarine, blend across all the cities of North America, Starbucks everywhere, McDonald's everywhere, Montreal stands aside. And it's because there's this wonderful intersection between Italianness and Francophone culture, celebrating a different kind of Canadian, being a different way of being Canadian.